Praise the Lord, brothers and sisters following us on this channel. I welcome you all in this service. It is another opportunity for us to share the Word of God and to hear what the Lord has for us on His heart today. I want us, before we enter into the hearing of the Word, to say a word of prayer, and then we will carry on from there. Father, we thank you for your loving kindness. We thank you for your presence with us. We thank you for your hand. We thank you for being with everyone, Lord. I know it's not easy for all of us to gather together in the same place and worship you and praise you together and have that kind of corporate anointing and presence of the Lord together. But I know you are all over. You are called Emmanuel. You are called Emmanuel, omnipresent God. You are everywhere. I therefore pray that wherever these your children are, whether in their homes, whether driving, wherever they are, Lord Jesus, I pray that you will bless them, Lord, whether in their offices, wherever they are listening to this message, where they are in the, wherever they are, Lord Jesus, in different places. Bless them, Jesus. Bless this message, O God. Bless whoever is going to listen to this message, O God, and let our lives be changed, be transformed to a likeness, Lord, both the listeners and even me, the speaker. I worship you and I open up my heart, I open up my life, I open up my mind, so that your spirit will use me, Lord Jesus, to utter the right words from your mouth, O God. Bless you and love in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I welcome you again. Today, the Lord has pressed this message on my heart, the message that says, seeking the kingdom of God. Seeking the kingdom of God. Seeking the kingdom of God is a message that was first taught or preached by Jesus Christ. If you remember well, when Jesus was baptized, before he began his ministry, after being baptized, the Bible says he got out of the water, and when he got out of the water, the Bible says, and heaven opened. And the Holy Spirit came upon him in the form of a bird. And the Bible says, then after that, he was filled with the Holy Spirit. And when he was filled with the Holy Spirit, the Bible says, the Spirit led him into the wilderness to go and pray. And you remember how he was tempted. But after the 40 days of prayer, the Bible says, that is chapter 4 of Matthew, the Bible says, then he began his ministry. And when he wanted to go and preach the good news of the gospel, in chapter 5, the following chapters after chapter 4 of prayer and fasting, the Bible says chapter 5, chapter 6, chapter 7, all those chapters were preached. They're the sermons that he preached, that he taught when he was on the mountain. So one of them, the sermons, you know, the Beatitudes, so one of the sermons that he preached at that mountain is this one that is found on chapter 6, verse 33, that says, seek first the kingdom of God. So I gave this message that seeking the kingdom of God. This is the message that the Lord has pressed on my heart. And I thank God I'm teaching the sermon that Jesus also taught. He taught it. He said, seek first the kingdom of God. I was keeping on asking myself, why did Jesus, of all things, so he taught so many things, of course, you remember, even when he was closing his ministry and gave us this, what he called the Great Commission. In chapter 28 of Matthew, closing verse 20, he said, go to all nations and change all nations into my disciples. Baptize them in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. But again, teaching them after that, teach them to obey my obey whatever I commanded them. So this is one of the things that he taught that we should remind ourselves, is to seek the kingdom of God first. So I was asking myself, why did Jesus, of all things, request us, ask us to always seek first the kingdom of God? It's because God knows, as people of the people of God in this world, we seek so many things. We seek for so many things. We pursue a number of things. And whatever is important in our lives, we really pursue that. Talk about education. You pursue education from childhood. Until, I don't know, these days you can even go on and on until you get PhDs. You pursue what you like. You want to talk anything that you give importance in your life, in your family. You pursue that. You seek for that. You run after that. You chase it until you get it. So Jesus saw in the hearts, and he knew that the people, his own people, will pursue a number of things. So he said, I think there's something that is very important that I should tell them, that I should inform them, that among the list of so many things that they pursue, that they seek, that they run after, there is one that is supposed to be the first thing, the first pursuit, the first something that we should all pursue. And he said, this is the kingdom of God. Seek first, not second, not fifth, not tenth, but seek first the kingdom of God. So I was saying, God, how I pray in the name of Jesus that I will not miss all this. You know, you can seek for tenth thing and fifth, and you forget or you ignore the first thing that Jesus asked us to seek. And this is the kingdom of God. So if you make the kingdom of God number one, as Jesus' intention, that is Jesus' intention. He saw that we get to grasp, to understand, to have his kingdom being number one in our lives, and the rest will be sorted. Actually, he says, and the rest shall be added. So that means it's good to know, I want us to know, why did Jesus really ask us, request us, his people, to seek first the kingdom? It's because of so many things, of course. But I got about two or three. Number one is all other things that we will pursue, that we seek, that we run after are temporary. Only the kingdom of God is permanent. Only his kingdom is permanent. So Jesus said, how can these people wake up early in the morning chasing something that will not last forever when there is something that is eternal called the kingdom of God? I think this should be more than, this should be given the top priority of all things. Actually, in the book of Ephesians, I think chapter 5 and verse 10, the Bible tells us to discern, to figure out whatever is pleasing unto God and do that and go for that. In Ephesians chapter 5, I think verse 10, the Bible says, try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Try to discern. Always try to discern what is the most important, what pleases God above all things, and go for that. So the most important thing, the most thing that pleases God, the most thing that is first in God's mind is his kingdom. Is his kingdom. So when you have chosen, when you have sought the kingdom of God, you have sought, you have found the real thing, the first important thing in the mind of God. The kingdom of God is the top priority in Jesus. And why? Why is it the top priority? Because we said it is the permanent. It is the only permanent thing. All other kingdoms in this world will go away. The kingdom of God has been there before the foundations of the earth. The kingdom of God is still there. And the kingdom of God will forever be there. It is eternal. All other kingdoms have changed. They have changed. They are changing now and again into some become republic, others federal government, others so many things. Kings have come and gone. But there's one king that is always there, that will forever be there. That is King Jesus, our master. He is always there. So if we are going to pursue something, let's pursue the eternal things. And this is the kingdom of God. So it's good when Jesus says, please, among the things you run after the kingdom of God as number one. Because all other things will fade away. All other things will change, will go away. But the kingdom of God will remain forever and ever. We have seen things come change, they come and go. Things changing. They come and leave us again. But the Bible says in the book of Matthew, chapter 24 and verse 35, the Bible says, heaven and earth will all pass away, but the word of the Lord, my words will never pass away. So we, as the people of God, we have to stick to something that will not go anywhere. And this is the kingdom of God. It will reign forever. It will reign forever. It has reigned. It is there permanently. It is eternal. So we, as the wise people, we have to go for eternal something. And this is the kingdom. This is the kingdom of God. And therefore, and when he says, it does not mean that he wants us to neglect, to ignore that there are other things to pursue. But let's pursue other things. But after sorting the issue of this top priority in the eyes of God, which is his kingdom. So this is the first thing that we should seek. He said, seek first, not second, not third. Seek first the kingdom of God. So help us, Lord, to always remember that all the things that we pursue, we run after every morning, every day, we have to know that your kingdom should always be number one. And if you have never, you are a sister, you are a brother listening to me, and you have never accepted the Lord Jesus as your personal Savior and Lord, you have not entered into this kingdom yet. You have never allowed this kingdom. So this is point number one. I don't know how many years you have. You have been pursuing so many things, but it's good now. You can stop and have a break and consider your future and know that how of all these things I have heard, what was my number one? Was it the kingdom? If not, it's not yet too late. You can bow down and accept the Lord Jesus in your heart. And you welcome that kingdom and you will settle all other things. Why? Because you have received the kingdom in your life. So, and when you receive the kingdom of God, it doesn't mean all other things, all other duties. They are also reasonable. All other things that sustain our lives, they are also very important. But they are not first like the kingdom should be first. So they are certainly important. The old other things are also important, but should actually, the Bible says, when he says, seek first the kingdom, he did not stop there. He said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and the rest shall be added. Meaning the rest are also important. The rest could be whatever. The rest could be education, could be work, could be so many things are in that rest. But that rest should not come to be number one. The top priority has been well defined. It is very defined. It is not in the rest list. It is defined as first seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then all other things. Sometimes we do it the other way around. What he calls other things, what he calls the rest, we put it to be number one. But number one should be seeking the kingdom of the Lord. Help us, Lord. Always put your kingdom on the top priority. So all other things are not God takes. He cares for us. When he says seek first the kingdom, it does not mean that he doesn't care about the issues we have, about other things that help our lives to flourish or that help us on an every daily basis. So actually, he considers that and he says, I will supply. You remember, this is Paul speaking. He was telling Philippians. He says, my God
I know my God in the book of Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. He says, and my God will supply every need of yours. He was encouraging the church of God. My God will supply your needs according to his riches in glory, but in Christ Jesus. So he will supply all your needs in glory in Christ Jesus. That is the address of whatever our needs, of whatever needs we have, should be Christians. All that we need should be found in Christ Jesus. As we make the kingdom of God the top priority, as we seek the kingdom of God, whatever we need, we will find it in the kingdom, because the kingdom has everything, both the eternal and whatever is intemporal and essential for our lives, even this time that we are living in. So it is good to know that, again, apart from its permanency, Jesus asks us or requests us to seek first the kingdom, because he knows his kingdom is there. I love Jesus. God can never ask you to run after something, to seek something, to pursue something that is not there. He knows his kingdom is there. Whenever you seek the kingdom, it is found. It can be found. He can never ask you to seek for something that is not there, that you can never find. He asks you to seek for something that is there, and the kingdom of God is indeed there. So when he says, and we see so many people, so many testimonies confirming that I have sought God, I have sought the Lord, and I have found him. You remember David giving this testimony. Whenever he was overwhelmed by fear, overwhelmed, worn out. But the Bible says when he sought the Lord, he found him. In the book of Psalms, chapter 34 and verse 4, we see him testifying, saying, I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and he delivered me from all my fears. He delivers. Whenever we seek him, he responds. He answers. When you cry out to him, he responds. He responds. So when Jesus says, please seek first the kingdom, it's because he knows whenever we stand to seek his kingdom, to pursue his kingdom, it is found, the kingdom of God can be found. Thank God, God did not ask us to look for something that is not there, that is just a fiction, that cannot be found. Thank God there's the kingdom. Thank God, whoever is listening to me, and you have never accepted the Lord Jesus, it's good you know that that kingdom is vivid, is there, is there. This is David is testifying. I have sought the Lord, and he answered. And he actually did not only answer, but he delivered me from all my fears that I had. He was overwhelmed. Are you overwhelmed? My sister, my brother, seek the kingdom. Seek God. Call upon him. He will answer in power and authority. And no wonder there is this promise in the same sermon that Jesus was teaching on the mountain in the book of Matthew, chapter 7 and verse 7. He says, ask and it will be given. Again, he says, seek and you will find. I love Jesus. Seek and you will find. Seek the kingdom. It is, you can find it. It is there. Seek and you will find. This is a wonderful promise that the Lord has given us. Seek and you will find the kingdom of the Lord. So where do we find it? Because sometimes people can say, okay, they told us the kingdom of God is there, so we are going to seek and pursue it. How do we pursue it? Where do we find the kingdom? Where is it located? Where is the address of the kingdom? Is it in heaven? Is it on earth? Where is it in the church? Is it on the missionary field? Where is the kingdom? Where is the kingdom? So it's good to see where the kingdom of God is. Sometimes we think it is in a very big sanctuary. It is, but the kingdom of God is just tonight or today. The Lord pressed this word on my heart, saying, the kingdom of God is just in these three words.
that Paul spoke when he was talking to Romans, the book, to Romans chapter 14 and verse 17. He said, for the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. So the kingdom of God has an address. And address number one is called in the righteousness, in peace, in joy, in the Holy Ghost. That's the address of the kingdom of God. So sometimes people think the kingdom of God could be somewhere else. You know, you have to be a very big pastor, a big bishop, some titles. But the kingdom of God is receiving the righteousness of God, is receiving the peace of God in your life. Not just in the sanctuary, but in your life, accepting, receiving the joy of the Lord in the Holy Ghost. So that's why Paul, when he defines the kingdom of God, he defines it with these three words. And by the help of the Holy Spirit, we will go through these words and we see how we get this kingdom into our lives through these three. When he says the kingdom of God is not, when he says is not, he doesn't stop there. He keeps on telling you now what it is. When he says it is not a matter of eating and enjoying, because eating and drinking are on the list of what we call the rest. But the most important is the righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. So now we have seen that the kingdom of God is three, is in these three words, the righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. So where do we find them now? Where do we find the righteousness? The righteousness, you can't buy it anywhere. Neither can you work for it. The righteousness of God that helps us enter into the kingdom is a gift that we just have to accept, that we just have to enjoy, that we just have to embrace, that we just have to allow to say, God, thank you for this gift of righteousness. Other kingdoms, getting into other kingdoms, other nations, you have to have a visa that is even costly, costs some dollars. If there are no agreements between countries, it will be expensive for people to move from one kingdom to another. But the getting into the kingdom of God, the only ticket, the only visa, the only thing that is required is accepting the gift of the righteousness, free gift of the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And you are there, and you are in the kingdom. Free gift. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us this gift of righteousness, O Lord, that gives us access into the kingdom. So righteousness, when you say the kingdom of God is righteousness first, it means that, wow, it's good to know, where do I get this righteousness? You don't need to go to so many places. You don't need to do a lot of good works. You just have to accept this righteousness as a gift of the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's why you see in the book of Romans chapter 5, verse 17, the Bible says, for if because of one man's trespass, just because of the trespass of one man, the sins of one man, death reigned through that one man, and much more with those who receive the abundance of grace and free gift of righteousness will reign in life through one man, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So righteousness, for it to reign in our lives, hey, for the kingdom to reign in our lives, we have to have this, to accept this gift of the Son of Jesus, of the Son of God, who is Jesus Christ. So this is the, he's the one carrying, he's the carrier of the kingdom. So accepting him, we are accepting, we are hosting, We are accommodating the kingdom in our lives by accommodating, by allowing this Jesus into our lives. How I pray that whoever is listening to me, Lord, will accept you, Jesus Christ, that will open up for you. As your word says, that I'm at your door, you're knocking. When you open, I will get inside and we will eat together. Eat with someone today, Lord. Share your life with someone, oh God. Help someone, Jesus,
so that he will embrace and receive this righteousness of God, because it is a gift, like your word says. So the Bible has said, just like sin and death came into our lives through one man called Adam, so will the righteousness reign in our lives through accepting Jesus Christ. So if you are listening and you are asking yourself, how do I get into the kingdom? What is the kingdom of God that I was asked to seek first? What is it? It is this, number one. It is the righteousness. It is accepting the righteousness of God. You are entering. That is the one access of getting into the kingdom of God. And so when you are there now, the Bible says in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, the Bible says, for your sake, he made him. For your sake, for our sake, for my sake, for your sake, for the world's sake, he made him to be sin. He who knew no sin. The one who knew no sin, he was made sin. Not only sinful, but he actually became sin. So that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So you see, we become the righteousness of God. Not because we have done a lot. Not because of the families we come from. Not because of the nations, of the countries, or the continents that we come from. Not because of any other thing, but just because we have received the righteousness of God by accepting the gift of the Son of the Lord, who is Jesus Christ. So that is number one as the entrance of the kingdom. It is the righteousness of God. When you receive, when you accept the righteousness of God as a gift, not just as a work that you have worked for, accepting that gift, the Son of God, is receiving the kingdom of God. So point number two on the chapter, on the verse that we read, when Paul was saying, when was defining the kingdom of God, he said it is one, righteousness, but two, it is the peace. It is peace. When you have peace with God, when you have peace with God, you are in the kingdom. You are experiencing the kingdom of God because you have allowed the peace of God. So how do we access this peace of God? This is also not bought in any supermarket. You can't find this peace anywhere. You can only find peace in the words of God. You remember when Jesus appeared to his disciples, when he appeared before them after his resurrection. You remember, he first presented himself to them and he showed them the hands and the side where he had been pierced. And he told them, peace be with you. They were, you know, overwhelmed. They were struggling. They did not know what to do. So when he appeared to them, he told them, peace be with them. Why? Because you see where this place, he showed them where he was pierced. You see me here? I was pierced for your sins. I was pierced here. I was wounded that you would be okay. I was this so that you will have peace. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, by accepting Jesus, you are accepting, you are allowing the Prince of Peace in your heart. You are allowing the Jehovah Shalom in your life. So accepting Jesus Christ, you are accepting the kingdom in your life. The kingdom that has peace, that is full of peace, that is ruled by someone called Jehovah Shalom, who is the Prince of Peace, who has all the peace that doesn't come from the account, the amount of money that we have on account. The peace that does not come because so-and-so gave you something. The peace that doesn't come because of this and that. The peace that comes because you know you have accepted the Lord and you are forgiven and you have accepted the Lord Jesus and you have no issues with God. When you have peace with God, when you know you are forgiven, then you have peace with God. You have peace with God. That's the kingdom in you. You are already in the kingdom. So I think we, It's good to know that the kingdom of God within us is not something in heaven or something in a very big... No, it is accepting the Lord. You are accepting the kingdom. You are entering into the kingdom because you have peace. You now know you have peace with your God. And the peace of God is in you. And every day, you make sure that Jesus is with you. You remember in the book of Romans chapter 5 verse 1, the Bible says, therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. There is no one else, no other peace. No one, nowhere else can we get peace apart from the peace that we get when we receive Jesus Christ. We are therefore, when you are justified, you have peace with God. You were to be judged. You were to be condemned. You were to be thrown away. But when Jesus came, we were forgiven. When he died for us, we were forgiven. And the Bible has used the word justification. We were justified through faith. And therefore now, we have peace with God. Not because we were righteous. Not because we are not sinners. But just because we have been justified. And therefore we have... So what gives us peace now? Because we are justified. Actually, the Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 8 verse 1 that there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. When you are in Christ Jesus, you are not condemned. That one in itself gives you peace that you can't get anywhere else. Just because you know you were supposed to be condemned, you were supposed to be judged, and now you are justified. You are called the righteousness of God. You are justified, not because you deserved, but because the Lord just loved you and you have accepted him in your life. This is how we get into the kingdom. We get into the kingdom. We seek this kingdom. We run after this kingdom. We pursue this kingdom of God through accepting the Lord Jesus, accepting the righteousness that was given to us as a gift through Jesus Christ, accepting the peace that we get when we accept to be justified, when we accept the Lord Jesus Christ. And finally, the last one is the joy. Paul, when he said, kingdom of God is righteousness, peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. So joy is our strength. The joy of the Lord is our strength. The joy in our hearts. When you see Jesus in the scriptures, when you worship songs and anointed preachings, like we sing the songs in his presence, the joy that you feel in the songs of worship, praising your Lord, your Maker, worshiping him, bowing down, raising, the joy that you feel there in his presence, the joy that fills the heart, that one is our strength. And that is the joy that comes from salvation. The joy of our salvation. It is the same joy, actually. You remember the verse that we read in the book of John chapter 20, and verse 20, when Jesus presented himself, when he came to his disciples after he was resurrected, the Bible says he showed them where in the side, on his side, where he was pierced. He showed them the place. He said, look at this. But it is amazing what they said. The Bible says, when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Can you imagine? They saw him, pierced hands, pierced ribs. But the Bible says they were very glad. So that kind of joy of knowing the one who was pierced for you, who died in your place, who died for your sake, who, that kind of joy, who say, oh, what exchange, what an exchange. So that kind of joy that you get by knowing, oh Lord, I'm now called a son of God. I'm a child of God, not because I deserve it. A former sinner,
now is justified. The joy that is there is a joy that you cannot compare with the joy that someone gets because there's a paycheck coming. Father, how I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you help us understand all this, that you help us what the kingdom of God is in our lives in this earth, Lord. In the world that we live in, the kingdom of God is just these three things. Righteousness. When you are in the right standing with God, you can examine yourself and see, am I in the right standing with God? Can you accept this gift of righteousness that you get by accepting the righteousness of God? When he died, the one who was righteous became sin, that you can become the righteousness of God. Can you accept that gift? That's the entrance, the beginning of being in the kingdom. And that is the first place, the first that you have, when you choose that, you have made the priority, like Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God. Then after that, that is your nature. We are not perfect, but we are perfected in Christ Jesus. Can you, if you're here, if you are listening and you have accepted and you have ever accepted the Lord Jesus, stay in Christ Jesus. You will be perfected. You may not be as perfect as you want, but as long as you have started this journey walking with Jesus Christ, he will perfect you. He will change you. Not worry, you may not be, you know, very, 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 very spiritual. But as long as you humble yourself to God and you allow Jesus to walk with you in this life and you walk in this kingdom, you'll be perfected. Your behaviors will change. Help us, Lord. Help change our behaviors. Help us, Lord, that we keep on changing, becoming more and more of good people, Lord, on a daily basis, Lord. Fill us with the peace that you have given us, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for saving us from the wrath of God, the wrath that would otherwise destroy us at the end of the world. But we now have hope that we will enjoy your glorious presence in heaven, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us that peace that we will live with forever. Thank you, Jesus, for we now have a mind like that one of our Lord Jesus Christ. The peace of mind that knows, that understands that we will never be condemned, that we have been justified by your blood, Holy God. We bless you, Jesus Christ. Thank you for the joy, for the excitement that we enjoy when we praise, when we sing, when we worship you. The joy of the Lord is our strength. The joy that we find in knowing in your kingdom, Holy God. Father, we thank you. We bless you. We thank you for this opportunity that you've given us, Lord, to learn about your kingdom. Your kingdom in the word of God has been likened to so many things. To so many things. Your kingdom has been likened to so many things. But thank you for this day that you have taught us, oh God, that if we can grasp that the entrance of this kingdom is through you, Lord, you are the king. You are the one that will take us into your kingdom. This is your kingdom. We bless you. And I pray for this world, for my friends, for the people of this world that you died for the nations, Lord, that they will know that your kingdom is the only kingdom that is eternal. All others will change, will fade away, will go away, will be no more, but your kingdom remains. It will remain forever. Help us, Lord. Seek this kingdom that is eternal and do not be stopped by something or so many things that are temporary in our lives. We love you. I bless you, Jesus. Thank you for blessing these wonderful people. Bless them for wherever they are, Jesus. Let your good hand be upon everyone. We bless you and love in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, dear brothers and sisters, for following. God bless you. See you next time.